It's a real pleasure to introduce Roger Molina, who is known to some people as the Roger of Leonardo, but who is also unknown to most people as an astronomer. And we thought that since we're talking about physical corporeal touch and prosthetized touch, encounter as opposed to prosthetic, you're going to get a full dose of it, because Roger is specialized in telescopic touch and in telepistemology. And I think that if we're talking about all this kind of virtual hype, let's get real and talk about light years. And I asked Roger for some keywords. He gave me some wonderful keywords. Can I spell with these just a little bit?
Sure.
So he's very involved with touching at a very long distance, but it's not just spatial, it's also temporal touch, because he's talking about being in touch with galaxies which no longer exist, and how this changes our awareness of the world, and our awareness of immediacy and proximity, and I think these are very interesting issues. So some of the keywords he came up with were collaborative touching, in other words, collaboration between human and intelligent machine at a distance, proxy touching, which is of course something pretty intrinsic to our extraterrestrial exploration. So there are a few mentions of extraterrestrial activity. And archaeological touch, in other words, precisely this issue of studying the universe as it was in the past, studying the phenomenon that no longer exists. So I hand over to you.
Thank you, Sally. I have to admit, I feel like I walked into the paint factory, David's paint factory. I know that the end there's a box of paint that's called Touch coming out. And since I only arrived at lunchtime, my problem is to figure out what goes in the inputs of the factory. So at the end, Touch is the result. The second problem that I have is I came this morning from a conference in Paris, which is called the Texas Symposium. It never happens in Texas, but this year in Paris, it happens every 3 years, and it brings together about 1,000 astronomers, all the astronomers interested in cosmology and the study of the universe on the largest scale. And so the second problem that I have is a problem of vocabulary. You've all been here for about a day and a half now, developing some shared vocabulary. And I keep hearing the second part of a conversation that began at lunch yesterday. And so part of what I'm going to, maybe the restaurant is a better metaphor than the paint factory. I'm going to try and connect with your discussions on touch here. And indeed, I have a couple of bridging ways to do this. As Sally mentioned, I'm a working scientist, working as an astronomer in a laboratory in France, in Marseille, at the moment. But I also am the editor of Nature Journal for Leonardo, and so I get involved in these discussions, try to understand where we're going. As part of that, as Sally also mentioned, I'm working on an essay for a book that will come out next year. The author is Ken Goldberg, who's a research engineer in Berkeley, but also an exhibiting artist, and indeed, the title of his book is The Robot in the Garden, the opposite of the soul in the machine. And indeed, it seeks to address questions of epistemology. What can we know and how can we know it when you're knowing things through devices at a distance that you communicate with? And indeed, I think that this topic of touch is one that I can relate to. And what I've done here today is I have a number of small set pieces, which I will try, I may not get to all of them this afternoon. I also have a few slides that I've brought, so I'd like to do sort of alternate between the set pieces and some of the slides. And the slides are there not so much to illustrate what I'm talking about, but to give you an idea of, in my work as a scientist, the kind of world that I inhabit, the imaginary world or the physical world that I inhabit, which of course conditions what touch means to me. So I'll go to set piece here. So I've been asked to contribute to our discussion from the perspective of a scientist rather than an artist or a musician. My original training is in physics and in astronomy. But my main activity as a scientist has been the designer and builder of instruments, which of course is a very long tradition, not only in the sciences, but in the arts. So I work within a scientific research laboratory with teams of scientists and engineers and technicians, building all kinds of devices that intermediate between me and the universe out there. In some cases, these are observatories that are launched into space around the Earth, to get above the Earth's atmosphere, to be able to see things that we cannot see from the ground. In other cases, we're building devices and robots that will be sent to land on other bodies, planets, within our solar system. And indeed, one of the groups at the laboratory where I work right now is helping build a robot that will be sent in about 2001 to go land on a comet, pick up a piece of the comet and analyze it and study it. And indeed, there are other projects that plan to bring back pieces of the comet, back to the Earth. And so indeed, in a very practical sense, the kind of science that I do is not only one of observation, but also reaching out and actually collecting things, touching things that are in the world that I study. So if I can now go to the first slide, maybe you can just turn it on for me. To turn that light down. More recently, the kinds of instruments that I'm involved in building are things like these satellites. And the way that I kind of look at this kind of device is that it takes a team of 50 to 100 people a few years to build one of these. One of these devices, one of these tools, represents several hundred years of people effort invested in putting together a device that will then be sent into space to probe and study the surface of planets or the sky that we cannot see from the ground. This is an example of a particular kind of instrument that some of you will be familiar with, since it was probably the biggest internet event in the last few years, the Mars Sojourner robot, which was sent by JPL. I didn't actually work on this project. We built devices to work on similar kinds of robots. And so this is a device sent out there as a proxy toucher, indeed, to go on the surface of a planet for it. This is the kind of device that we use to propel our tools into space. In this case, it's a rocket launch of a satellite called UVE, Extreme Ultraviolet Explorer, which I helped build at the University of California, Berkeley, and is still in orbit right now, as we speak, going around the Earth every 90 minutes, looking at part of the sky that cannot be seen from the ground because the Earth's atmosphere blocks it totally. Leave that slide as my segue slide. That was in a slide on the table. So I'd like to put the topic of extraterrestrial touch within the social context of a working scientist. And this is a bit of a caricature, but in fact, as I've discussed these kinds of topics with people, I found it somewhat helpful. At one extreme, I'd like to put the worldview of the settler. The settler builds instruments to extend his senses, to study the universe at a distance, and then through the acts of thought, to understand the universe and the phenomena within it by making up explanations, models, mathematical theories, and testing these against what we know about the world and can discover about the world. The settlement mentality accepts certain constraints. For instance, that the Earth is our home, our ecological niche. The human destiny is to be conceived of within the framework of this planet, and to reach out to the stars, we build telescopes and to allow us to extend our senses to see further and with more detail things that we cannot see unaided. We can also build satellites and robots into space and our physical representatives to visit other places. Whether it's the surface of the moon, the surface of Mars, or indeed explore the surface of a comet. And even now, there are teams of engineers and scientists who are designing the first robots that will be sent out to the nearest stars and will eventually reach them long in the future for our future generations to listen to the signals from. So for the settler, the planet is a place of finite resources and a finite duration. Sending humans into space to colonize or migrate to other worlds is costly, unnecessary, and maybe even undesirable. And indeed, this kind of worldview is one that most of the astronomers that I know sort of share. What they're really interested in doing is understanding the universe, and they view this almost as a spectator sport. And it's a very well-established, ingrained set of assumptions that in fact motivate the kinds of ways, the kinds of tools, the kinds of devices that you will build. Let me switch now back to some other slides. So this is the view of Europe, leaving the Earth, looking back. You can see all the lights in France, England, and Holland is probably the brightest place. So going out into space, that's the home looking back. This is the observatory that we operate from the University of California, Berkeley, that's there studying the sky. And even as we speak now, it's pointing at stars and sending the images back to the ground. This is an artist's conception of a sculpture in orbit around the Earth. It's not up there yet, but it's already visualized. And Arthur Woods, the artist in Switzerland, is trying to build it. And so indeed, the settler mentality can be contrasted with the mentality of the migrant. And so I want to contrast this worldview in a caricatural form. I think it does underlie the kinds of approaches that different people take to touch extraterrestrial worlds. For the migrant, the planet Earth is but a starting point, a birthplace, and our destiny lies in finding and overcoming the barriers to extraterrestrial migration. The instruments that I will build are not only extensions of my senses, but in fact necessary to modify my physical nature to allow me to survive in new or hostile environments. For the migrant, the building of a telescope and a robot is but the initial step, it's the foreplay before building space stations, habitats where humans eventually can move out and explore and evolve on a different cultural track. And I want to argue that the touch of the settler and the touch of the migrant are of a different nature fundamentally. The touch of the one seeking to internalize the world around the distance, the other seeking to externalize the world within. And even though these are sort of caricatural, I think they're useful ways of looking at the different ways that the settler and the migrant considers touching extraterrestrial world. So this is a painter's conception of an astronaut fighting in space. Actually, it's a painting painted by an astronaut after he came back to the ground. Others have various conceptions of what extraterrestrial worlds would look like. This is actually a Connecticut painting by my father, Franklin, that made in the 1950s in Paris. Indeed, space can be viewed as a very friendly place where you would take your dog and do your cooking in this illustration from Jules Verne's book. Or it can be a cold place like Antarctica where there's nothing to be seen except the horizon and of course the footprints that we've left behind. Of course we take with us many cultural assumptions of what it is to touch in a foreign place. In my sort of scenario of the settler of instruments as extensions of the senses, and in many cases, this is in fact is an appropriate characterization. When as an astronomer, I build a telescope to study a visible object, and I know that if I then go touch the object that I see through my telescope, it will be there. Indeed, the story is told, and it's probably apocryphal, that Galileo Galilei, as he was beginning to use the first telescopes, would point them at the mountains and the hills across the valley, and then he would actually get his hiking boots on, I guess they weren't hiking boots then, and walk across the valley and go touch the rocks that he had seen with his telescopes to convince himself that his machine was not hallucinating. Then he could announce with confidence that when he turned the same telescope to the surface of the moon and saw mountains, that they were mountains. That he, through the act of touching, in fact, had been able to confirm, justify, substantiate what his perception told him. When I, as an astronomer, build a telescope that detects infrared light, for instance, I know if I go touch the objects that I see with my telescope, they will be hotter or colder, depending on how much infrared radiation they're putting out. Infrared radiation happens to be a very good measure of the heat content of an object. When I study the sky with an ultraviolet telescope, I know that if I should go out there and put my skin in front of that object, I would get more or less sunburn, depending on how bright things were in the ultraviolet. However, in a number of ways, and a number of people have written about this, it's profoundly misleading to think of telescopes and sighted instruments as extensions of my senses. My instruments are not all just preambles to touching, but some of them, in fact, are of a different kind of nature. So this is an earliest conception from the 1940s, I think, of a human settlement on the moon. Earth rise looking back from the moon. This is a more industrial vision of what we might view on the surface of the moon. It's a mining settlement, a vision by an artist in the 1950s. There are the tracks that we've now left on the moon. No traffic jams there yet. So indeed, in the first place, many instruments provide me with extensions of my senses, but other instruments provide me with new senses that have no equivalent in my body. When I build a radio telescope, like the first one that I showed, I see a universe around, and I make images that are profoundly misleading of what my telescope sees, because my body, in fact, is conceptually, physically incapable of detecting radio waves. So it is not a matter of amplification or intensification. It's actually a matter of converting information from radio waves to something that my body can sense. And indeed, I bring with myself all my intuitions that have to do with the senses that I know about in interpreting those radio images. The same is true for telescopes that detect X-rays or gamma rays, other forms of light the body is incapable of detecting, or neutrinos that travel through matter. They travel straight through the Earth without stopping. And these telescopes to detect neutrinos don't look at all like the kinds of things that we put in front of our eyes. And there are now telescopes that detect gravity waves. All of these telescopes detect things which we are physically, conceptually incapable of detecting directly. And so when I use these devices, they are not extending my senses. They are really adding me new kinds of senses that provide me other information about the world around me. I can never even conceptually go touch the things that I see with those new kinds of telescopes, not because they're too far away, or the objects are too big or too small, because they do not exist in a way that I can then directly perceive with my own senses, even if amplified. And so the kind of perception that I have is of a different nature, where in my everyday world, the world that I see or smell or taste, it is continuous, the world, with the world that I can touch. When I see something, I can go touch it. However, the world that I see with these new senses, these new kind of telescopes, is discontinuous with my touch. There is no conceptual way that I can go take the image from a radio telescope and then go try and touch the thing that's emitting the radio waves, because in fact my body can never sense it in any direct kind of way. And so those kinds of objects or phenomena are conceptually non-touchable, even though I can perceive them and incorporate them into my view of the world. And so I think we have to think in a different way about how we can experience touch for these kinds of situations. Of course, this last remark actually intuits our obviously another factor. I can extend my sight or give myself new kinds of sight, as I just described, but I cannot extend my hearing into space. Once I leave the Earth's atmosphere, there are no sound waves. Space is inherently silent until I get to another planetary surface with enough atmosphere on it that sound waves can travel again. And so there is no such thing as a sound telescope in astronomy, and indeed, sound is quantized, it's fragmented in the universe around very localized places where there is an atmosphere that can carry that kind of signal. When I'm standing on the moon, I can feel the vibration of the ground from your approaching footsteps. There is no way I can hear them, both my smell nor taste, except on planets which are very similar to my own. And so indeed, whereas sight is almost a universal sense, taste and smell and hearing are very special kinds of senses associated with our own particular kind of environment. And so if you like, touch and seeing are universal senses, but taste, hearing, and smell are local senses. By sending a robot to touch, just as the Martian robot touched the rock in the slides I have been showing, I am extending the kinds of senses which have continuity with my perception. But there is no way I can send proxy touching to places that I cannot perceive directly. So this is a view of the planet Mars as we're coming into orbit around Mars with the polar cap on the top side. We can turn the lights out a little bit. This is the surface of Mars where you can see some of the features from the flow of water on the surface. You can sort of see the sand that's been washed around the rocks. Some of those are wind patterns, some of them are water. And so the Sojourner robot landed on the planet on a parachute, and then it bounced, inflated these big balloons, and the robot is inside that cluster of balloons, and the robot bounced about five or six times before settling. The air then deflates from the balloons, revealing the little robot hidden inside that cocoon that's protected it as it landed on the surface. And in fact, that surface is frighteningly similar to what your backyard might look like in some parts of California. It is comprehensible, and indeed the cameras on this robot have been carefully tailored to mimic the human senses. It's no accident that it looks familiar because the cameras on that robot have been equipped with lenses that mimic those of the eyes so that you back at home would feel at home seeing the images. Here is the picture of Sojourner touching a rock, although I have to admit that particular picture was done back on Earth while on the planet Mars, even though it might be quite hard to tell the difference. And hence the problem with tele-epistemology. How would you tell the difference between a virtual world that is highly, very well simulated and one where, in fact, you sent a proxy? I have said that as an astronomer, my sense of sight is not always continuous now with my sense of touch. I cannot necessarily experience the things that I perceive. There is another way that the astronomer view of the universe is disjoint. One of the projects that I'm working on is a project to study and understand the origin and evolution of galaxies. To do this, we build telescopes of a particular kind that look in the ultraviolet to look at the most distant and very faintest galaxies in the universe. And one of the most amazing things to me is that indeed today, an astronomer with the devices that we have at hand can study the universe over the bulk of its history since the initial Big Bang that led to the phase of the current universe. But as you all know, the light that we see now has taken millions or billions of years to reach us. So that I am seeing these galaxies as they were, not as they are now. Even if I were to try and go there, the galaxies that I am studying would not be as I see them now, and indeed may no longer exist as galaxies as such, because many galaxies collide, cannibalize each other, and get absorbed. so when I got to that galaxy to try and explore it, I would be studying the galaxy as it would be in the future, not as it was as I saw it when I left. So the objects may no longer exist, they're discontinuous with my perception, and so the conceptually, even if I went to touch them, they no longer exist in the way that I saw them at the time that I took the picture. And so whereas today the rough surface that I see is rough to the touch and the smooth surface is smooth to the touch, this reassures me and allows me to venture out without fear into the world that I perceive before entering. On the other hand, the distant universe that I see with my telescope is more like the world seen by archaeologists than the world that I live in today. It's a world where I can be a spectator, but not a participant. So this is the view of the surface of Mars where Sojourner landed. You can see the two mountains in the distance. And as you all know, one of the things that the teams of scientists and engineers did is that they put a name on every rock they could see in the picture. And I think Yogi Bear is the little rock there to the right that the Sojourner is about to go visit. And so this is teams coming down the ramp. There was probably a picnic basket waiting while the photographer is just outside the frame. Setting up the lighting. Because the lighting was perfect. You can sort of see how frighteningly familiar that landscape is. And as I said, it's no accident that the cameras on the device may mimic human eyes. That's some kind of a prehistoric symbol on the surface of the rock. It's a hieroglyphic. You don't know how to read it yet. Someone was talking about it. It doesn't want to understand certain messages. I'd like to go into a different comment now, which is one that is worth expanding on a fair amount, which is that my instruments are not just extensions of my senses in another way today, because they are beginning to have minds of their own. My instruments are now highly computerized, and computers can be viewed as very advanced technologies of memory. The robot that I sent to the other planet, or Mars, or the comet, the observatory that is orbiting the Earth today, it knows, and that's a slippery word, many things that I do not know. The robot collects information about its environment, and it analyzes it, sorts it, interprets it, stores it, and then because of the limitations of telemetry and radio, it only sends some of that information back again. In many cases, I can then decide to go back to that robot and probe its memory and find out what it knows that I don't know yet. But in many other cases, the robot itself will decide that information was not of interest and erase it from its own memory. Indeed, the new Martian robots that are being built now are being equipped with really what can only be viewed as primitive intelligences. This robot itself, because the communication time between here and the surface of Mars is in the tens of minutes, had to have enough autonomy so that when you told it to move, it would not suddenly roll down a hole that you hadn't seen because it was just behind a little rise. And so this robot had enough autonomy to keep itself from tumbling down a hidden hole. And indeed, if during the communication period the robot had kept moving, I would never know that that hole was there on the surface of the planet, but the robot did. The robots that are being built now can make a number of internal decisions about what they're going to do next, depending on what's been happening. And so, for instance, if you were studying the weather on Mars with one of these devices, you might decide that an average day is of no interest, and you would just erase that data from the computer memory. But as soon as the wind got a little bit higher or hotter, then it would record that memory and send it back to you. And there are different ways that a robot can define what is interesting and then send it back to Earth. Indeed, in some of the most sophisticated robots, this is an adaptive process, where the software that you load into the robot modifies itself depending upon the environment that it finds itself in. So even though you may know what the software was at the point that you loaded it into the machine, 10 years later, you may have no idea what the computer memory of that machine now contains, because the software has evolved internally into the machine. So even though it's tempting to think of the robot as an extension of my touch, as it is in this case, the robots that we're beginning to build really need to be viewed in a different kind of way. I can no longer pretend that it's just an extension of my own locomotion, but it is a primitive being collaborating with me, exploring another world. The robots that we're beginning to send to Mars tomorrow are more like dogs going with us on a walk in the countryside. They indeed share the same world with us, and they can touch the same things, but they also see and hear things and smell parts of the world that we are blind to. And so that collaborative activity of working with these robots that are getting more and more sophisticated is one of collaborative touching, where indeed neither one of us will have the complete picture, but only the two of us together, or many of us together, will indeed be able to build a self-consistent view of what the world is like. So extraterrestrial touching is not only the reaching out of the migrant, but also the reaching in of the settler. My instruments and telescopes not only devices of remote touching, but of remote being. I'm not just made more sensitive by these instruments and telescopes, but I am in the process transformed into a different being with different desires and dreams and needs.
Thank you. blossoms, which is one thing never seen, because they never achieve that. Well, they write it down, and it becomes a textbook to discover.
I disagree with the way you're posing the problem, because I take the senses as sort of an antithetic view of existence, because, and as we were talking about before, when you're listening to music, it is not a sound experience. And the combination of a number of things coupled in different ways, and somewhere in here you're making a model of what you are hearing, it doesn't, I mean, it is not. I mean, there is no way that this apparatus is single modal at any stage of perception. And David was talking about some of the coupling between the visual and the sound apparatus and so on. And so, I don't think the world is, I don't think existence is that way, it is that way. And most painters that I know talk about the kinesthetic experience of painting, just as the dancers do. So,
well, what I meant was in the sense that in this synthetic aspect of reading as pure synthetic instruments are in the state of your
statement that computerized instruments have great trouble integrating multimodal information, right? And that is a level that very few robots are able to do. And so they tend to analyze things in linear channels and then combine scenarios and overlay them. But in fact, if you're within the settler mentality, it would just plain dumb. And it's one of those things to do, because if you take the point of view that the human being arose out of this environmental niche and will never be able to live in space, then it's just the average. Right? But if you take the migrant point of view, it's inevitable. Right? And this tension exists within our society, whether it's settler to migrant mentalities in society at large or within the community. And so there's no doubt that the migrants had the upper hand in the 1960s in the United States, and it was coupled to other reasons. Right? But if you just want to study the moon, it does not help to have human beings there, they just need trash.
There wasn't anything gained, except politically.
Well, it maybe is a little bit quicker, because at the time, the computers that we had 20, 30 years ago were not as sophisticated as now. But if you really want to study the moon today as the moon, the way to do that is to send different kinds of robots to probe the moon.
Well,
and in fact, the book by by right called the overview effect, which basically is irreversible once you've been there once. Right? Once you've been there once, there is no way, and the myths are forever affected by that. And so, you know, I have to be a migrant. I'm an American, born in Paris, worked in California, and then living in Marseille, right? I would like to go to the moon. So the fact that someone did it once is very positive for the human mythology. And we cannot write mythology the same way now that we've actually been there. So I agree with you. The psychological and mythological impact is tremendous.
But also, from the point of view of this conference, isn't there something gained from knowing what it's like for a human to walk on the moon and knowing what that gesture is like?
And I guess that's part of what I was trying to explain. That's only if you accept that everything you can see, you can touch. Right? But the universe is not like that, the world out there. I mean, there are many things out there. There is no way we as human beings can detect, see, or directly apprehend. And so, you know, as we add new senses, there are parts of the universe you can never conceptually touch. So those radio images, I will never be able to walk there and touch them because they're not apprehendable by my senses. So yes, you're right in the sense that the parts of the universe you want to visit are the ones we can see and touch. But there are parts of the universe which we cannot both see and touch. So I agree that within that framework,
there was the question whether they had been really there. Somebody did you know they were there?
Well, and in fact, if you go see Ken Goldberg's website, he now has 5 or 10 small Gedanken experiments where your challenge is to figure out whether it's a real thing at the other end or a simulated thing. And in fact, it's in most of these cases, it's impossible. There's no way to determine that. Now, in this case, I guess there are ways that you could, and the Russians knew, didn't they? There are other ways of photographing those people on the moon other than CBS television.
When you said something interesting about development of
we're all going to need to have a little UV patch on our shoulders so we know if the ozone layer is 2 pins a day and we're going to get skin scanner in 3 minutes, right? So pretty soon we're going to want to be equipped with patches of skin that are responsive to ultraviolet radiation. And that will come by coupling some biotechnologies to the body. I think it's very unlikely that the human body will evolve new senses. And I think it's coupling the new kinds of ways that
differentiate between the settler and migrant mentalities. I'm really interested by this issue of to what extent information that is beyond our grasp because of its quantity and its complexity has to be translated back into seemingly form in order for us to assimilate the streams. I think you were saying that there are conceptual or happening which to use these particular lenses, non technical phenomena. And then when you look at something like Ryan Robbins, maybe nuclear, he's dealing with non-touchable phenomena and interpreting them into a haptic form that we can appreciate. Do you think that your migrants, as opposed to your circuits, are more open to accommodate the ungraspable or the
inaccessible?
Or they're both just as helpful?
I think they're both equally valuable, equally successful, actually, in the history. Both strategies are viable strategies. But I think, and part of what I've been trying to develop in this essay is, and in fact, Wessel's talk was an example of this, and the ability to conduct an experiment is really crucial, not only to the little cats developing that perceptual system, but to the whole scientific method, right? I mean, this ability to close that control loop in some way is a huge bootstrap. In terms of comprehensibility, believability, all those kinds of things. And so the fact that I can send that robot over and have it push a rock down a hill, right, assumes of a human understanding is a different domain. And so I think it's maybe not so much the act of touching, but the act of being able to do something and see the world change as a result. And I think that you can do even with senses that are not essential to senses.
In an earlier conversation, you said that in experimental situations, the robot might not be good enough. That you'd rather have human touch there. Did I understand that?
This is a huge debate. The people who are building the space station that's going around the Earth and will house astronauts, they argue that we are hundreds of years away from a robot sophisticated enough to notice things that are really interesting to follow up. And so that human being who's in that space capsule doing things will notice things that are very, very subtle, a little bit wrong, and then follow those up. Nobody knows how to build automated devices to do that. And so their argument is that the presence of humans in space is just necessary for pragmatic purposes. I mean, there's no way you can build a sophisticated enough robot to notice unusual things.
Well, I find it amazing you have this robot to have a degree of one themselves that what they touch is real. And so you have this consensual reality from looks at robots as part of mitigating what information is sent out.
Right. A lot of people have written about this problem. I mean, what you're talking about is not very different from how a human community agrees on what things should be studied, can be studied, how they can be studied, right? So the fact that there are primitive robots in that equation doesn't change that problem. I mean, there are still a consensual situation with which we as human beings are involved in that decide which things are worth doing and which things are not worth doing. So I don't think the robots change that equation as I understand it. Right?
I have a very basic question. I work with the infrared lights and the instruments where you can see how to see the effects. And it would be very interesting to me, I've tried to get hold of the university physics labs and the military side of things, a way that I can get very glasses to see it, or the audience to be able to see it. Either you or somebody else, is it possible to get something like this? An instrument like this to be able to see it?
What you can do is you can take a normal CCD camera and take off the infrared filter most CCD cameras have. For instance,
so you can see the shape of the humidity that you can see where it's coming from. And you can see
for it.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, most things have heat signatures, and normally on a CCD camera, which is a normal surveillance camera, they filter that out. And you can just break open the camera, take out the infrared filter, and go into the camera. Did you get the sort of Terminator 2 assuming you're in a dark space, otherwise the visible light will block out. What I was referring to earlier was that in the first we intended to equip robots with the kinds of senses that we have, motivated by when I send a robot onto the surface of Mars, the one that you saw there was dropped from a height of 5 miles and landed on the surface and survived. And you cannot do that
sense of the balance in the world, but the robot may be quite happy company, right? And so it's pretty nonsensical to equip have many robots now that you see coming out are designed so that whatever way they are up, they can keep rolling, right? I mean, and no longer, they don't have to, long have to stay upright. So the senses adapted to that survival are different ones than the ones to our survival. I mean, that doesn't mean that if you want to agree on something out there, whether it happens or not, we better have some overlapping senses somewhere, because if the robot only sees regular waves and I only see visible light, we may never agree that something happened. Fortunately, all human beings have roughly the same senses, except the ones that have other senses, right? Developing senses to react to that situation, we might not understand conceptually what kind of phenomena they were trying to react to. I'm not sure I can think of any examples right now. Sense, you should be able to predict what sense is relevant to the construction of the perception. Really. I mean, if
any nucleus might be a tender.
Well, I mean, it's also like it's a synesthetic thing, because I mean, you can get visual distortion as a result of auditory.
not coupled with conscious processes or many aspects of sensing.
Well, there's a lot of things there. I love the autonomy question, but I want to go a little further with it. So the idea, let's see, these autonomous robots, at a certain stage, it seems that what you described in your talk is the idea that somehow we send these things out there, and then we decide that something is really there, but we don't agree. And if we finally agree, whoever person is, then whatever the stuff is, so this seems to be a community developing. And I really like the idea of robot collaboration. So the thing that I'm sort of interested in was following on this idea that somehow we want these robots to somehow find the interesting thing. And as we probably recognize, if we put 10 people on, they would probably find at least 5 or 6 different interesting things. So it depends upon a lot of issues, how they grew up and what the kind of experiences they've had. And I was just wondering, first of all, when these people build these robots, are there a lot of artists involved in these things, or are there people who think about collaboration or dialogue in that way? I mean, for example, people who study improvisers or people of that sort of thing. I mean, basically, that sort of thing. Or maybe
my impression is that you read Minsky and those kind of people. I mean, those people will take ideas anywhere they can find them. Mm-hmm. So, my impression is that there are artists and people thinking from that point of view involved in some of the robotic experiments. I just want to tell them
that. Yeah, you must know something.
I'm working that way. Yeah, and I interact with people who are close to me to us. And when I go home to my lab, I sometimes have trouble with the questions I bring back with me. These kinds of things. In reaction to what you just said, I just want to tell an anecdote or an example. It's a fact that human mythology has a very close connection to mythology and cosmology, to what we perceive with the human eye. And if you go out into the night sky every night, you can see about 6,000 stars to the naked eye or something. And there are very few things that change, a planet or a comet. They're very rare. The things that change in the night sky are very rare. That's a total accident of your human eye. And so the mythologies and cosmologies that we've developed over centuries say that in the sky, things that move or change are gods or portents or warnings, and that these are all very deeply ingrained things. And that is as an accident of the sense of the human eye. If I happen to be an animal with X-ray or gamma ray eyes, every time I went out into the street and looked at the night sky, it would be different every month. Every hour, the night sky dramatically changed. And so that animal would look up there and everything is just changing and moving, and occasionally you'd see something that was there all the time. And so your God would be the thing that didn't change, right? And so, indeed, what's interesting is almost a total accident of what your eye is tuned to. And if the human eye is tuned to the part of the light where the night sky doesn't change every night, then the X-rays, it does. And so the interesting thing there doesn't change. And in my universe, the interesting thing does change. And that's kind of an extreme example of how closely coupled those concepts are tied to the way that we see.
But why are there so many different cosmologies? At different ways of looking at that. I can buy that if I believe that fundamentally we all have the same senses and it's simply an accident of birth that we develop in this way or that way, but it seems to be things develop over as part of a community of things that go beyond like transductive motions. I'm a little uncomfortable with this kind of universalizing.
No, I'm not going to claim a reductionist. This kind of sense leads to that kind of mythology. I mean, that's not the case. But it's certainly true that what you interpret as important in the environment around you depends on how you go about detecting things. And that's not universal, but it, how you go about knowing things, right? And what are your knowing strategies? And each one of us has combinations of those strategies of internalizing things that we see and externalizing our thoughts and acting on all the world around us. And so I don't want to sell that particular metaphor too strongly, but it's just a really vivid way of expressing the difference between an astronomer sitting there and looking at the universe, making maps, and trying to explain what he sees, and actually sending a robot out there or human being out there and looking under the rocks. Right? It's a different process than knowing, and it's very deeply ingrained socially within the scientific culture. These different ways of doing it. Yes, there are different terms for migrants and settlers, and some of them are not terribly tracked.
Well, I was just hoping in science that this kind of science in particular could benefit. I don't know if it's possible to really incorporate different models of different culturally oriented models of this model into the framework of these new robotic devices. You start to see if it's solving from one culture.
Back to the business concept. We build into those devices all kinds of concepts of what the devices do. One of the things that keeps me involved in astronomy is, even though it's one of the oldest sciences, what people have wondered about, what we now believe about the universe has no recognition to what people thought 50 years ago. And so, and that's because we want to develop these additional senses and maybe different ways of probing the world out there. It involves both looking and touching. Good thing when you turn around the table there, right? I mean, so it's intentional that you have the sense of punch and the sense of sight to both confirm there was a table there in the way when you walk into the room. But indeed, if only your sense of touch told you the table was there, not your sense of sight, you get into trouble. And so, indeed, as you build up these multi-dimensional displays, you need redundancy. And you need internal redundancy to get the sense of the
tone
of it.
When Fred Brooks says, for example, in virtual worlds, people don't want to walk into obstacles. No, this is wholesome. That's fine. That's Fred Brooks and he's an admirable scientist, but it's an extremely prosaic view of the thinking that these worlds that we're building should lend themselves to other, further types of these experiences that do have their incompatibilities, that do pose problems, that do have discrepancies with respect to.
I heard Benedict give a talk recently about virtual worlds, about the lack of unnecessary information in the world. And indeed, light also. It's going to happen that you can see it in some other way as well, even though nature may not be that tight. Right? Nature may have certain kinds of phenomena which only are visible in certain colors. And so indeed, what's meant is that different science analyzing the same data will make different images, right? And then it really gets uncomfortable, because it's bad enough when you can't get confirming data. And so there are whole layers of things there in terms of the credibility of what you see.
So you can't kind of apprehend that? Or that there's something between you and the data?
No, and you know, most image synthesis systems give you color palettes, but I don't know who designed them, but I mean, they're made for certain kinds of things, and nothing to do with the barrel of grayscale, in terms of not misleading.
Similarities, which is only if you just change the hue from okay, this is a very large grain of cultural composition, which is the clear composition, where there's you have to all do all this whole huge thing. It's like a batch processing with huge mainframe things. And then you have this very small grain type of thing, which is this dialogue with this thing that's right here because it's in the moment. And so it's more like timeshare. And so mapping that to the whole process.
audience, so you need to read reviews about that. You come back, you need to revise your composition. But the next audience, you never ever experience an audience. And so I find this is kind of a fascinating what that composition process you have can be creating this exploration.
Why you're talking about this reminded me of the fact of Manana's full intro arrived in Israel, he's a Lambda, and 15 years he's been trying to convince NASA on one of these Martian missions to take one rock and put it on top of the other. And this is a trivial thing to do. He has been unable to convince anybody within the scientific culture that is an interesting thing to do. it's that intentional sculptural act, which he does in the Negev desert all the time, and then he's built into a hole, seven things.
Can I ask you a question about the spin-off of the work that your group does? Do you expect that the technologies or tools that you develop could change our notion of touch on Earth? Is any of that technology, do you expect that can be applied here on Earth?
The robotics community integrated together.
Are you, for instance, working with really remote touch, the remote controllers where you have sort of feedback, force feedback?
They're the fact that this means that you need control systems which have very long delay times. And so you get into sort of a problem regime, which is.
Is that still?
The autonomy remote control equation is very different than on a robot here.
Is any work being done, even though the time delay is barricade?
Why would the time delay always be a barricade? As long as it's synchronous. It's delayed.
It's like the internet.
No, but it just puts a huge premium on local autonomy for most decisions.
Just think of a simple case where you manipulate a rock, put it on top of another rock. Suppose you have a 10-minute delay. Why is that a problem? This rock is not going to move by itself.
It might take you 30,000 tries to get it to stay there. The advantage of the artist in the desert, right?
You just have an opposite.
Is you have that very short control loop.
I realize that. Isn't all you have an offset in time?
You have an offset. I mean, if you're in control theory, that then changes the main nature of control in exercise. So, you end up with much more distributed systems than you would with short controls. If you've got a robot inside a nuclear power plant that's going in there to try and turn the tap off, whatever they do, there you can have feedback systems and so on that are basically give you remote manipulation. But that makes very little sense if you're manipulating on the surface.
I don't really understand it.
So, but what you're saying here, anybody? I think just that the robot has to be able to do certain things by itself,
right?
But I mean, I'm not understanding what you're saying.
No, maybe.
There seems to be a joint process here. Robot could be doing certain things itself, and then you're sort of doing certain things.
I see it as if you're trying to improvise a duet with someone, and you've got a delay between you and the other person.
But there is no delay. It's an option. I mean, your actions are also delayed. So,
you pick up the rock, and it'll take 20 minutes to figure out how to do the rock.
Yeah, once, okay, but after you've done these 20 minutes, aren't you then synchronous?
Well, because new things are happening,
especially
in the case of the new things. So, from that moment on, aren't you then in touch? Maybe I'm completely
ridiculous. You can do the improvisation if everybody just slows down. Everybody slows down and only does one thing every 8 minutes.
No,
but you can't stop it, yeah.
Well, the supervisor better have enough scores so that when you're in contact again, you're still vaguely lying. Maybe not, I guess.
Well, that is an interesting issue. Are these robots synchronized, first of all? How much of a score do they need? And is that score, is the notion?
action based upon certain kinds of rules that it has coded, where they got things that will likely be holes, the bugs, those kind of things. So, yes, these robots will improvise strategies versus to achieve certain goals.
You don't have a problem with that, right? I mean, that's amazing, because I suppose the realm of power people have a lot of problems, and I'm wondering why.
That's a problem in power more than in certain.
Yeah,
that's
what I'm trying to say. Yeah.
Improvisation damage. The realm can choose between various paths to go to landing, and improvisation seems to acknowledge different kind of things, like intention to play on. And I don't think the realm has a kind of intention, like, oh yeah, well, how can I jump to, or how can I do only one leg or something like that? There's this kind of intentionality. It's getting from A to B. And you can do that in various ways.
It's like jumping. The improvisation isn't on the turn of the upside down. It's an outrageous.
Discussion about the nature of memory as memory not being a fixed human capability, one, but one that is very closely coupled to a social context and to a technological context. And indeed, you know, why remember all those phone numbers when your computer can now store them, right? And so the kinds of things that, that your attention will go to will depend upon what machines can do. And that is sort of a social cultural process different from the two kittens. And so there are two different kinds of situations, both of which come into play. And there's no doubt that some of the problems of the technology, comes with it certain kinds of things that it does easily, and certain kinds of things that it doesn't. And so that biases.
Yeah, I understand that. But,
when the interaction is something that is, you know, 5 light hours away, to do certain kind of things jointly will be very, very difficult.
Not so much of doing jointly, but learning to perceive differently. You know, like you learn from the different modes of perception that these robots have been programmed because they can't do it. So that actually affects us, so that then we can be able to adapt and then perceive the world differently. I'm thinking about the way it's
that's what we're talking about all day.